Aviv Regev is a professor of biology at MIT, a core member at the Broad Institute, and an investigator at the Howard Hughes Medical Institute. Dr. Regev pioneers the use of single-cell genomics and other techniques to dissect the molecular networks that regulate genes, define cells and tissues, and influence health and disease. So welcome. Thank you very much. I'm going to stop sharing. And I believe you're going to present from your...
From my own laptop. I should just say all of those things were correct, but I'm actually no longer at the Broad in the HHMI. I was faculty on leave, but by now I'm not even that. I'm in Genentech, but today I'm in my capacity as a co-chair of the Human Cell Atlas Organizing Committee. And my other co-chair is Sarah Teichman, but she's, I believe, actually on an airplane right now. Let me share my slides. And I'm going to tell people a little bit about the Human Cell Atlas. Hopefully you can see them in full slideshow. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the Human Cell Atlas. You're not seeing like a weird window in the middle saying chat, right? You're just seeing my slides. Great. Excellent.
Yeah.
So I'm going to start. I'm sure you covered this in the opening session of the day, but I think it's always useful to remember that cells are really the basic unit of life. And cells come in many shapes, types, and forms that really characterize them into their types and their functions. And we can classify them by their structures, by where they are in the body, by the functions that they execute, and also by the molecules that they express. Now, cells are really essential for us also in order to understand the genes that cause disease. So all cells in our body have the same DNA by and large. And if we have a variant in our genome that increases our risk of disease, all cells in our body have this variant, but the disease is only going to manifest based in those tissues and cells when the gene is really active and expressed. And so knowing the cells is essential for our understanding of the genes that cause disease. The only problem with that is that, as you've learned in the, I don't know if I'm going to spoil the trivia, but there's 37.2 trillion cells in the human body. The textbook might tell you that there's maybe a couple, maybe 300 different kinds of cell types, but if, say, you're a neuroscientist and you study the retina, you know that there's more than 100 different subtypes just of neurons in every retina. So obviously there's a mismatch between those two things. So we don't really know ourselves. This was really a big stumbling block for many, many decades. But technological breakthroughs in the past decade have really allowed us to understand cells better. So up to about 10 years ago, roughly, really the main way in which we could study cells was to take a lot of those cells together, mush them up in the lab equivalent of a blender and measure their average. And of course, given that there is many different states and types of cells, this would give us very crude approximations. If you think about every cell as a piece of fruit, you can call this the fruit smoothie. Single cell genomics allows us to profile individual cells. So it gives us something that's more similar to a fruit salad. We can distinguish the different kinds of fruits, but also within every kind of fruit, we can distinguish, say, between bigger and smaller strawberries, ones that are redder versus less red, mushy and hard, and so on. And finally, with spatial genomics, since our body is not actually just a fruit salad, our body has beautiful spatial patterns and they're very important. With spatial genomics, we can actually see the fruit tart. The advances of these technologies and the importance of cells have led us to establish way back in 2016 a new international initiative known as the Human Cell Atlas, whose mission is to create comprehensive reference maps of the types and properties of all human cells, the fundamental unit of life, both for our basic understanding of biology, but also for our understanding, monitoring, and treating in health and disease. HCA has had now more than 5 years of existence. In 2016, we had our kickoff meeting. By 2017, we released our white paper and we're off to really data collection efforts. And through these efforts, our community really formed, both as a scientific community, but also in generating a lot of data and the computational tools that are needed in order to analyze it to generate insights. So just to give you a flavor, since 2018, when we opened our registry, we have now reached scientists in 86 countries, spanning almost 1,500 institutions and over 2,600 members across the world. HCA is really engaged in the need for an atlas to be global, equitable, and fair. And that means equity both in the data that is in our atlas, we need it to really reflect human diversity, and equity in the scientists that build this atlas. As a result of that, our data collection has really skyrocketed. You can also see the big inflection point between 2019 and 2020, such that there are now samples from many thousands of individuals, many thousands of samples, and tens of millions of cells. And by latest count from our current survey, over 100 million cells, almost 110 million cells, across 18 different organs and systems from almost 10,000 individuals and 13,000 samples. And in addition to all of those, through our concerted effort around COVID-19, more than 12 million cells from COVID-19 patients and their samples in order to understand that disease. In this process, our goal is to really help scientists impact our understanding and treatment of disease. And this spans everything from better diagnostics and biomarkers for clinical trials, new regenerative medicine tools, meaning new cells that you can implant into patients, better understanding of the causes of disease that can direct scientists towards the right therapies, and finally, a relationship to those risk genes that come from human genetic studies. While the atlas itself is focused on the healthy reference, it is its application in comparison to disease that is going to give these answers. And just as a few quick vignettes, this includes identifying the rare cell type, evading scientists for 30 years, now known as the ionocyte, which is the cell type in which a rare disease gene like CFTR for cystic fibrosis is actually expressed. It is to understand infectious diseases like COVID-19, providing insights both to the routes of infection of the virus and the evolving variants over time, as well as the way in which it causes pathologies across the human body. In cancer, understanding both the basic disease mechanisms in cancer, both in the cancer cells and in immune and other microenvironment cells, building predictors for the outcome in patients, and also defining new treatment regimens. And then finally, in common complex diseases like inflammatory bowel disease or IBD, relating the genetic changes that come in our germline to the cells through which these genes act in order to identify where to intervene therapeutically. These are just very quick glimpses from the Atlas. Now, HCA is a global partnership. It's a partnership between scientists, and it's a partnership between scientists and their funders. The Healthy Human Atlas, Human Cell Atlas, is built through support by many different funding agencies from all across the world, both government agencies and philanthropies, to name a few: the NIH, the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the Klarman Family Foundation, the Wallenberg Foundation in Sweden, and many, many others. But also in a partnership with the Human Disease Atlases that are funded by a whole other slew of funding agencies, because we can only understand disease in reference to the healthy, and we often only understand health in reference to disease. Now, we're, as I said, at 100 million cell mark or so. This is actually the goal we set ourselves at the 5-year mark, and we exceeded it, and that is to be our draft first version atlas, with the next 5 years being devoted both to integrate this atlas happening right now and to work towards a comprehensive atlas at the cellular and the spatial scale and spanning the needed human diversity. And with this, I will conclude and really look forward to the panel.
Thank you so much.
Let me stop sharing and I'll turn the screen back to you.
Thank you. All right. So what we're going to do is we're just going to, as I said, introduce everybody, present for a bit, and then we'll open it up to questions from the audience and some questions we have prepared. So the next person I'm going to turn to is Sanjay Jain, and I'm going to just put you up here on this. And Dr. Jain is a professor of medicine, pathology, and pediatrics at the Washington University School of Medicine in St. Louis, Missouri. His laboratory focuses on how kidneys and the lower urinary tract develop and organize to maintain homeostasis across lifespan and health and disease. He leads multiple NIH-sponsored atlas efforts to map healthy and disease states in the human kidney, including HubMap, KPMP, RBK GoodMap, and the Pediatric Center of Excellence in Nephrology. The team has identified, validated, and mapped 100 cell identities in the kidney, including health and injured cells, and defined genes and pathways that help recovery or predict decline in kidney function. So it's wonderful to meet you, And Sanjay, if would you like to present from your computer, or I can drive?
Yeah, I can do that. I can present from my computer.
That's fine. That sounds great.
Yeah. Do you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, thank you for inviting and the introduction. And thanks, Avi, for laying out the groundwork for the different Atlas efforts and the single cell and spatial technologies. So what I'm going to focus is just on the kidney. And in very simple terms, what we think about is a collection of molecular maps that are helping us understand the vital functions of the kidney, how to prevent injury and recover from it. And this is a effort, largely from two different consortia, HubMap, which is a human biomolecular atlas project, which is mapping every single cell from major organs in the body, and Kidney Precision Medicine Project, which is focused on disease biopsy specimens from patients who have voluntarily undergone biopsy procedures to donate for research. Just to give you a little background, why we're interested in kidneys. In simple terms, kidneys save water, they get rid of waste, they maintain our blood and bones, and a healthy heart, and which equates to, us keeping us alive. This is an evolutionary tree to tell us, like, as land mammals, we have undergone through several adaptations to enable our life on land. Without the kidneys and this intricate evolution of this basic nephron structure, we won't be able to survive on land in conserving water. And this is highlighted in one of these, sculptures you see all over Europe, where we should appreciate that being is a blessing, have is taken millions of years to come to this stage. So we have two kidneys, one on each side, luckily. And this is just basically a dissected what a kidney looks like when you take it out of the body. It's like a bean-shaped structure. This is the ureter. And if you cut it open, what you see is the outside, this area over here, this brown area is cortex. This part is the medulla, and it's very elongated over here compared to non-mammals. And this is what one of the long structures that help us conserve water. A lot of action is taking place over here. And this is just fat in the renal sinus. So when you look at the kidney, one of the questions we try to understand is that why should we make a kidney atlas and who is it for? So I've listed over here in red different kind of user personas, where or why these atlases could be important for. For example, a high school student may just want to do a science project, where they're trying to ask a question, it's about sex differences, they can go to the atlas and look at the data and then do that. A patient like my mother who has kidney disease, she may want to know that I'm leaking protein, what is causing this? And then she can go to the atlas and ontology databases and then find, where the, and look and then what is structures in the kidney that are causing this. An artificial intelligence, scientist may want to use the knowledge to create, by using machine learning, maps of structures that a non-expert can just use to predict, or a clinician can use to predict structures and diseases. Similarly, a tissue engineer needs this foundational knowledge base, to be able to design and engineer organs in a dish. Because once kidney fails, you have to get replaced kidneys, and there's organ shortage, all over the world. So in order to do all these, we have these two consortia. HubMap is dealing mainly with reference atlas, and the Kidney Precision Medicine Project is dealing with disease. So in order to understand disease, as we mentioned, we need to really know what a reference is. And our kidneys are constantly being damaged with what we eat and what our genetics are and how we age. So it's important to know all these changes across lifespan. So what should be in the atlas? We should define the anatomy all the way to the cells. We should have molecules all the way from DNA to the metabolites represented in the atlas, and that which link the genotype to the phenotype. So we are mapping the cell identities, the spatial relationships, and ultimately trying to relate this to the phenotype. So I'm just going to briefly introduce this, our kidney cell atlas version 1 from this project. It's a multi-consortia effort. The preprint is in bioarchive. These are the different consortia and many different institutes. And over here is just a snapshot of different technologies that we don't have to go in detail, and number of individuals which have been detail mapped, both from single cell and spatial technologies. So what does it look like, when we dive deeper into this maps? So this is a structure of the nephron. It's the basic functional unit of the kidney, which filters blood and then does a lot of excretion and absorptive activities all along the corticomedullary axis before the urine goes out. So what we have mapped is all these major cell types in these different parts of the nephron, both in healthy and altered states. This is a illustration showing one of the filtering microfunctional tissue units, which is called the glomerulus. The blood comes in these capillaries and is filtered through this intricate barrier and is goes in the urinary space, and then urine comes out of the ureter. We have mapped about close to 500,000 cells in this, and this is a map, basically a way to look at all the different cells in these different clusters, what we call, and each of these groups are different cell types in the kidney at a very high resolution. Some of these are depicting different regions of the kidney, which is shown over here. They also talk about different states of the kidney, which is mapped in these. For example, these are all injured states in these proximal tubules in the kidney, and these are all healthy cells. And then on the right is each patient is mapped. So for precision medicine, we can look at each patient and see what these patients are actually, you know, their phenotype is looking at the molecular level. So just give you an example. So this is basically a little illustration showing the healthy cells. When the healthy cells get injured, you get all these different kind of states. They can be transitioning, they can be degenerating, they can be renewing to repair, or they can go under transition states where they are again successfully repaired and come back to healthy states, or become maladaptive or fail, and then they lead to scar tissue. So we have got genes associated with all these different states in this first version of the atlas, and they have been validated in spatial context so that we know each of these cells where in this nephron it's lying. So this is a high-level summary, so of the maps of these states, and then the spatial relationships, for example, how the immune and the stromal cells in acute kidney injury and chronic kidney disease are neighboring along with other cell types in the kidney. This allows us to know what are the relevant receptors and ligands, you know, pairings that can be used for targets for drugs. We have also identified in these states that which genes can predict a decline in kidney function over 5 years over here, leading to chronic kidney disease. So in this atlas so far tells us about biology as well as disease states in the kidney. So a lot of this can be accessed by different types of user personas that I told you. And these are some of the resources listed. In HubMap, we have an Azimuth reference made by Rahul Satija. In Cell by Gene from CZI, we have this tool where anybody can go type their favorite gene of interest and see where in this map it's expressed. And then we have KPMP Explorer, where you can look at gene expression across multiple technologies in kidney space, in healthy and diseased individuals. And then we have the HubMap, this effort with, we have a detailed view of anatomical structures and cell types and biomarkers that Cardi Bonus Group has done, and then and which standardizes nomenclature across different consortia. So I'd like to thank the many, many more people who have been involved in this effort, and they are listed over here, and the PIs and the main people who have been involved in this project. So thank you, and I'll give it to you.
Thank you so much. Great, thank you. And let's now move over and give a warm welcome to Dr. Kristin Ardlie. And I'm going to just share this quick. Dr. Ardlie is an institute scientist at the Broad Institute, where she led the genotype tissue expression, or the GTEx project, which produced RNA sequence data from approximately 18,000 tissues from 960 human donors. She is working on two related efforts, the developmental GTEx project and the non-human primate GTEx project. In collaboration with colleagues at the Broad, she led technical methods developments for a single nucleus analyses of GTEx biobank tissues. And she is a member of the Human Cell Atlas Genetic Diversity BioNetwork and serves on two working groups. She is also involved in large-scale data harmonization efforts in the Common Fund data ecosystem. So thank you, welcome. And Kristin, you can either present from your laptop, or I can go to the slides that we have for you.
Okay, let me see if I can do that. Okay, thank you. Is that showing properly?
It is.
Okay. I'm going to talk about a project that I've been engaged in a long time and my perspective on human reference atlases, which is a project related to diversity across individuals called the Genotype Tissue Expression Project. This is the project in a nutshell, which is it was launched in 2010. So it predates the Human Cell Atlas projects that Aviv were talking about. We had a pilot paper in 2015, mid-phase in 2017, and a final consortium paper that came out 2 years ago in 2020. This is not actually the end of the data. We have actually had another release, which includes all 960 genotype donors. And there will be another release coming out early in the spring, I think, with the residual RNA and some other data types as well. So the goal of this project was to link non-coding regulatory variation to genes and mechanisms. And the hypothesis that was the foundation of this is that these functional effects of non-coding, in particular the genome-wide association disease variants, occurs through changes in molecular phenotypes, all of the phenotypes shown here, but particularly gene expression, which was one that we could easily measure in a population sample. So to do this project, we had to do two things, which is we had to measure these genetic regulatory effects that we were interested in across tissues and individuals. As Aviv articulated, genetic effects manifest very differently in different tissues because genes are regulated differently. So we knew we needed to look across tissues in individuals. But we also needed to measure genetic regulatory effects and genetic diversity across individuals. So we needed to assess the role of this genetic variation on gene function in both dimensions. This is the key features of the GTEx pipeline. Shown on the left is the human body and the brain and all of the regions that we sampled. In short, the project collected a large number of donors so that we could assess diversity and in particular genetic diversity here. We collected multiple normal tissues per same individual. These were deceased donors, transplant organ, postmortem donors from rapid autopsy and so on. We did it with quality such that the tissues were collected with low ischemic times and for the most part were very good quality. We had consent that permitted general research use, so broad utility of the data, and donor engagement, which in this case was donor next of kin engagement. The tissues were collected with extreme accuracy of the tissue sites, and that's because we set up how and where to collect these with coordinate reference systems. So this was before we had a notion of a common coordinate framework. And with consistency, because we had rigorous sampling of these tissues across donors and different sites, which involved a lot of training of the individuals at the sites. And we also have extensive metadata, including medical, histological, pathology, and many, many analytical covariates. The core data types produced were a genome, so in particular, a whole genome sequence, largely from blood, and bulk RNA-seq data from tissues and cell lines. So as I mentioned, this project started before the Human Cell Atlas, and this was, as Aviv described, the smoothie of each tissues. We just didn't have the technology to do differently at the time. But the data produced in all was an atlas of gene expression across all of these tissues shown, and expression quantitative trait loci, where we correlate genetics with changes in gene expression from over 17,000 tissue samples spanning 54 different tissue types from 838 donors in that V8 final consortium release. I'm not going to present any of the data because I know we're short on time, but I'm going to present one little snippet at the very end. In short, we found that genetic effects on expression and splicing are extremely widespread, and we probably saturated cis genetic effects for gene expression. But one of the things we noticed as we finished up this project is that there appeared to be that tissue was the wrong level to be looking at. However, we didn't have single cell data. So we did what we could do, which is we took a computational approach and deconvolved seven common cell types from the bulk GTEx tissue. And what we were interested in looking at was if we could look at enrichment of cell types, could we see a difference in these QTLs where cell type enrichment was low versus cell type high, as shown in this cartoon. And these are called interaction QTLs. We're looking for an interaction between cell type enrichment and the quantitative trait loci. And then we wanted to ask, can we co-localize these with complex common traits? And do we see greater co-localization of these types of QTLs than we see for the bulky QTLs? And what we did see is exactly that, as shown in the panel on the right. At the top is a genetic genome-wide association variant. And below it is the bulk tissue EQTL. And here we see no co-localization of the bulk tissue EQTL with the GWAS trait. Below that is the interaction QTL, where we do see co-localization. And in short, for approximately 35% of these GWAS loci, only an interaction QTL co-localized with the trait. The bulky QTL gave us no signal. For an additional 30%, we have found signal in both the EQTL and the interaction QTL, which suggests perhaps the cell type and cell type mechanism. So in short, we knew we needed to be at the cell level, which the project hadn't been. So a project we started towards the end, and this was actually done in collaboration with Aviv and Arit at the Broad, was to go back to some of the banked tissues we have and ask if we could use those biobanked tissues in single cell studies. Now, bear in mind, we didn't have fresh tissue and we weren't going to get fresh tissue for the types of studies that we're interested in, looking at large numbers of individuals across populations. It was going to be extremely hard to collect all those tissues in different geographic locations and keep them fresh. So we had to come up with a protocol that would work on frozen tissues. And that's now commonly used, and it's a single nucleus, single cell assay protocol. But here we went back to eight frozen banked GTEx tissues. We surveyed three individuals of each type and tested three different protocols on each and profiled about 209,000 plus nuclei. This was published in Science along with two other papers that did a similar approach and spanned what we call cross tissues in individuals. In short, what we found in that study is a large array of cell types here. On the right, you can see the different tissue types, and you can quite clearly see that the composition of cell types differs across those tissue types. But you can also see that within any of the tissue types, there's a good amount of similarity across individuals and even the protocols. Our analysis in that paper focused on a joint analysis, integrating across all those individuals and cell types, which enable us to examine both shared and tissue-specific cell types across the tissues. We were able to identify rare cell types that we couldn't see in any one tissue alone when we looked across tissues. And we were able to find tissue-agnostic and tissue-specific cell features. For example, we observed fibroblasts that were common across cell types and appeared to be performing the same function, and then saw a subset of fibroblasts that were very unique and tissue-specific in the different types of tissues. One of the things when you're working with sampling tissues is that spatial location matters, which both Sanjay and Aviv have mentioned. And we really need a framework of anatomical landmarks to map these in building a human reference atlas and to be able to integrate with other projects that have these scaffolds, including the brain initiatives, the human cell atlas, and HubMap. On the left here is an example from LungMap, where they've highlighted with the little boxes the specific types that they have, the specific regions sampled. And it matters where you are in this diagram, because cellular composition, cell function, and cell-cell interactions differ by location, as the former speakers have described. Now, in GTEx, one of the unique things we did is to do a top-down approach, as I mentioned, so that every tissue was sampled using a repeatable anatomical sampling design at the exact same location in different donors at different sites. And these SOPs describe the precise site, the size of tissue, the preparation, and the storage of the aliquots. So recently, as part of the Common Fund data ecosystem, I've been working on a project in collaboration with Catty, where we started to map these GTEx tissues onto the HubMap common coordinate framework. So here's an example of the tissue work instruction for GTEx. So the description of exactly where to sample. This is an example from the transverse colon, the sampling site. And then here's an example of how we map it to the registration user interface in HubMap. We've currently done this to capture 27 different extraction sites across males and females for GTEx. Associated with over 5,000 different tissue blocks and with our population level summary data. So both the bulk expression data as well as the EQTL data. And you can see those mapped here for both the males and the females. And the goal in doing this is that even for these tissues for which we do not currently have single cell data, we can now map across HubMap and see if we can extract single cell or spatial data as represented in the Human Cell Atlas and HubMap to tissues that are mapped to the same site. And I think that's all I have. In the interests of time, I skipped an acknowledgement slide, but there's a huge amount of people that need acknowledgement for this study. Thank you.
Thank you so much. All right. And let's turn it over now to our next presenter, James C.G. He is a professor of radiologic science in radiology and computer information science at the University of Pennsylvania. Let me just share his stuff here. Where his group carries out research in biological and medical image analysis and computing. Their team is best known for their work on algorithms for image processing and analysis, particularly image registration and segmentation, that enable group studies, digital atlases, and computational anatomy. They are recognized, too, for their commitment to translating research accomplishments into widely popular open source tools. The group software serves as a major community resource for brain atlasing and directly underpin hundreds of published imaging studies the world every year. So thank you, James. I have your presentation and I can put it up here. And then you can just tell me when to advance the slide. So I'll do that in just a second. Okay, can everyone see this?
Great. Thank you, Todd. Well, yes. I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk about anatomic atlasing in the living human, in the human brain in particular. Next. So the importance of imaging in biomedicine is well recognized today, but especially so for the brain. Next. One reason for this is that it's hard getting to the brain to physically examine it because our skulls and spines are in the way, exactly as they should be in their protective function of the brain. Next. So imaging is typically the only way we can directly assess the human brain while a person is still alive. And it's come to provide an important link between behavior in the brain and cognition that complements traditional observations made in people with brain lesions. And in this way has helped to provide converging evidence of how function in the brain is organized and where specific functions are located. Next. So while one basic problem that may be a little bit surprising to some of you is that despite the exquisite detail with which our images are able to detect the brain, we can actually have some trouble finding our way around these images. And by this, I mean it's not so easy to be precise about the location of things in the brain, even with extensive training. And this is in large part because our definitions of where the many different parts of the brain are located are not very precise to begin with. Well, if it's hard to tell what things are in the brain, how do you compare these things in different brains? Next. So for example, to measure, say, the amount by which parts of the brain may be smaller in patients who have a degenerative brain disorder when compared with people without the disease, this is important because where these differences are located in the brain could potentially tell us something about the disorder. It can also tell us something about the brain functions that may be affected by the disease. So here we've used serial imaging, MR imaging, to capture an estimate of the brain atrophy over the course of a single year in a group of frontotemporal dementia patients or FTD patients. In FTD, portions of the frontal and temporal lobes shrink. And these are areas generally associated with personality, behavior, and language. Some people with this kind of dementia undergo dramatic changes in their personality and become socially inappropriate, impulsive, or emotionally indifferent. Whereas others who have the disorder lose their ability to use and understand language. Well, I hope you can appreciate that the level of precision with which we can localize effects like these in the brain will potentially have correspondingly greater impact on diagnosis and possible treatment. Next. So what would be really brilliant is if we had something like a geographic map, except for the brains we've just seen. These maps could then be used to guide us regarding where we are in a brain, in the same way that Google Maps, for example, can tell us where we are in the world. Next. And indeed, these kinds of so-called brain atlases exist. But like any ordinary roadmap, these brain atlases are useful only if I know where I am in the first place. In other words, a nice tourist map you might get at a hotel in a foreign city isn't going to be a very helpful getting me where I want to go if I'm actually lost and don't know where I am on the map in the first place. This is why, of course, street maps at a subway station or a map at a shopping mall, you know, typically include some prominent symbol telling us where we are to help orient and position us within the map. So effectively, what we need in addition to our atlas or our map is something like a GPS for the human brain. That is something that gives us the coordinates or location of an arbitrary point in the brain, which we can then look up in our map. And I'm proud to note that this amazing breakthrough in brain imaging was originally conceived at Penn. And here's how it works. Next. The idea is based on the fact that to some level of detail, we all share a common anatomical or bodily blueprint. So all of us here, as far as I can tell, have two eyes, a nose, a rough symmetry midplane, and so on. And at the same time, there are obviously differences among us, but we can think of these as being shape or spatial variations on this shared blueprint. So my nose may be a little smaller or bigger than yours, my face may be rounder, and so on. Next. And now to the degree that this assumption holds, that there is in fact some bodily blueprint, some reference face in this example, of which my own and your face are just warped or rearranged versions. If this assumption holds, then the GPS capability that we want is the same thing as finding the correspondence between the reference face and my face or your face. Next. And by correspondence, I mean that for any location or position in one face, I'm able to find its corresponding position in the other face, as for instance, shown here, next, where examples of corresponding features in the two faces have been identified, namely the eyes, the nose, and mouth of the boy and girl shown here. Next. Here I've arbitrarily specified the boy's face as the blueprint, as the so-called reference face. And what's special about the reference face is that we have additionally labeled its features, next, just as an atlas would be annotated. Now, because we know where every position on the girl's face is located on the boy's, the reference face, or the face atlas, if you will, next, we now also know what feature, which each feature of the girl's face is called. Hmm. Next. And things can get even more interesting. Next. Because we can annotate our atlases with additional kinds of information as shown here. Next. The exact same technology applies to brain images. We can design computer algorithms that automatically find the correspondence, next, between a person's brain scan and a brain atlas, and then use this correspondence, next, to label the person's scan, telling us what part of the brain we've located where we're located at for every position in the person's brain image. Next. And just as we can carry information annotated in the atlas to label another image, we can also move the image pixels of the atlas itself. In other words, we can rearrange the atlas image according to where its points get moved in order to find these points into correspondence with the points in the other image. And that's exactly what's being animated here, where the atlas brain image in the preceding slide is now being spatially arranged or warped into alignment with the subject image that was labeled in the slide beforehand. Next. And we might want to mute that. Sorry, I didn't mean to surprise you there. But in returning to the face example, for any Michael Jackson fans out there, now you know how this music video, popular in the early 90s, was created. Well, although a heck of a lot less lucrative financially, we'd like to think our development and application of these methods for brain imaging have enabled instead a wealth of new knowledge to be gained about the brain. Thanks so much. Hope some of this was interesting to you.
Thank you. And at this point, we are going to open it up to questions from the audience. I have one that that came to me when I was listening to all of you. All of you mentioned to some degree the aspect of community, that you have a lot of people to thank. It takes more than a village. There's lots of acknowledgement, all this stuff. My question would be, how do you keep that community productive, happy, functioning? How does that work, especially over a long period of time and over a number of people? Aviv?
Maybe I'll start, because I think for Human Cell Atlas, the unique feature is there's no top-down organization that can actually tell anyone what to do. This is what is known as the coalition of the willing. People actually want to work together. And they want to work together because together they can do something that alone they can't. And that can be because one party has something that the other does not, different technologies. We just heard, you know, beautiful presentation from James on the computational side. Before that, we heard beautiful things from Kristin on the experimental technique side. And before that, from Sanjay on the kidney. If you really want a great atlas of the kidney, you actually need all these people. So there's a huge motivation to work together because you know you can't do it alone. And the other, even within an area, say all the computational people together or the technologists, by being open with each other, meeting together, telling each other what we do, we actually proceed a lot faster. Because instead of, you know, I'm doing something and you're doing something, and I don't know what you're doing and you don't know what I'm doing. And in the end, we ended up doing basically the same thing. By talking to each other, we accelerate our progress dramatically. We learn new tricks and new ideas, and we move to the next problem and the next problem after that and so on. So this community, at least the Human Cell Atlas community, really started on the basis of trust and mutual scientific respect. We actually thought we have a scientific problem to solve together, and we really trusted the people around us, and trust begets trust. And so we were open like that with each other, and everyone saw that it's going really great. So they joined in the party. And I think COVID gave us an additional inflection point on that, because it was such a crucial moment, and we had something to offer. Others had other things to offer, but we had our thing. And our scientists just all, they already knew each other, they were well-networked, and they were like, we're just going to do the work together. And we're not going to think about who's going to be this and who's going to get credit like that, and this is my data and this is your data. We're just going to solve the problem together. And we had the trust and the scientific understanding of each other. So that's really how we operate. And then everything else is in having the right activities that really ensure that that happens. You know, we have meetings, we write white papers, we write roadmaps together, we do actual research together. So these activities really nurture that, and we're constantly looking for what's the next scientific problem that we need to solve. And we put it in front of our community and we say, well, now we have to think about integration. Now we have to think about mapping in three dimensions. Now we have to, and whoever puts it up front is whoever is thinking about that problem right now. And that generates the energy for another round and another round and another round.
Thank you. Yeah, Kristin.
Yeah, I echo everything Aviv has said, and I will add to that and say, I think one of the things we've learned from these big projects is that we need to engage patients. In our case, even though they're deceased individuals, we actively engage the next of kin. We really need to broaden the scientific community to engage the individuals who are part of that and who will benefit from that. And I think the Human Cell Atlas has shown tremendously that we need to really broadly embrace the global community as well, in its scientists, in its individuals. We need to, we've got a global biodiversity network, there's an equity working group, there's an ethics working group, and I think this is really critical to engage the community above and beyond the scientists.
yeah, Sanjay?
Yeah, so, you know, I think on the same lines in the Kidney Precision Medicine Project, we have about 15 patients who form the Community Engagement Committee, and they are actually driving the projects. So they actively write our consents, because it is very important in data efforts like this that their sensitivities around, because we have patients donating there, they're taking risks. There are real risks of serious consequences of donating your tissue, you know, undergoing a medical procedure. So our patients write the consents and how the data can be used, you know, when they are forming these. And, you know, and they are very smart. After giving little background information about what we are trying to do, they give us very critical feedback on and ask us very pointed questions that are really relevant. You know, as scientists, we can go off tangents and go very deep into things. To patients, sometimes that may not matter if they can't really see why we are doing that. So this bi-directional feedback is really important for us. And we try to continue engage even community practitioners who are seeing actually patients in the clinic, you know, because they are our important user personas. You know, after all, I mean, we don't want to make Atlas just for researchers and computational folks, you know, and because it's intellectually very stimulating and so forth. We want it to be used. We want pharmaceutical industries to use that knowledge, you know, to build drugs and things like that. So this is very important, you know, in these kind of efforts.
Thank you. Yes, Aviv.
I wanted to add on the point. First of all, I wholeheartedly agree on the point on patients. It was already raised eloquently, but I did want to add on the point that Kristin said about going global, that to go globally, we learned from the experiences of earlier consortia, especially in human genetics, that this is not just about getting to diverse data, but it's really about engaging the scientists there who are in their communities, and they engage with the patients and individuals there. And we empower them to do their science. So it's not here, let's get samples that are more diverse and bring them over. It's really about the science has to happen in those places. And when I showed that map, you know, when HCA started, there was, you could literally see the top of the map had a lot more than the bottom of the map. But today we've had so much growth in Latin America, Africa, Asia, and generally generally in low and middle income countries. And this is not just growth in the kinds of samples that people analyze. It's the scientists who do the work. They are the physicians and the research scientists who are embedded in those communities. These are their homes. That is incredibly important. And it's especially important with cells or tissues, because the differences are not just genetic differences. They're actually also experiential differences. You have to have geographic diversity also for scientific reasons, because the cells behave differently based on the environment in which you live.
Thank you. Looking at the chat here, we have a question. Thanks for organizing this. Do you have any suggestion for cell type annotation in case of doing single cell for a brain region which does not have any single cell reference? What are the steps to build our own reference? Thanks. Yes.
Maybe I'll start, others can comment on this too. I think there's two levels for this. The first one is the first time anyone built a single cell profiling study, they definitely didn't have any reference. So you can absolutely take a page from the book of what those scientists did. We try to group the cells in different ways. You can cluster them, you can look for their gene programs. And then we come with whatever biological knowledge we already have and try to use that knowledge in order to give kind of the first level of naming. And often that evolves over time, the more and more you understand the cell. So I would definitely recommend doing that. It's also a great QC on whether the data is in the right place. I will point out that in the human brain, in the last few weeks, there was a release from the BICCN, the Brain Initiative Cell Census Network, that has actually profiled 3 million cells from very detailed, anatomically defined regions in the human brain across 3 individuals. This is actually the pilot towards BCAN that is going to do this in full-fledged mode for the brain. But this pilot alone means that the vast majority of human brain regions have now been profiled sparsely. There is some information out there, so I would strongly recommend trying to relate to that. The other thing to relate to is cross-species. The mouse brain is near completion. and has been done extremely deeply. And from everything we know from the regions that have been analyzed so far, there is a high degree of conservation. Not perfect, of course, there's new things in the human. We are not mice, but it can give you a first draft reference that you actually do cross species. And I should point out that the Human Cell Atlas does have an atlas integration effort that is following precisely in that direction for the human and mouse brain in collaboration, basically led by our colleagues from BICCN, from the now known as BCAN, the Brain Initiative Cell Atlas Network. They are the biological network in HCA parlance for the brain.
Thank you. And would anyone else like to chime in on that? If not, there's another question here. Question as to when to use an individual organ or human as a reference, a prototype, and when to use a more abstract, merged, or otherwise abstracted reference organ.
Well, go ahead.
Oops, no one was replying, so I should say something then. But I was hoping James or Sanjay will kick.
I'll just mention one technical issue to consider when regarding that question, and it certainly relates to the application and task of interest. So in my talk, I showed using these atlases, or these days called common coordinate frameworks, as spaces into which you map individual data. So in that particular context, if that's the application, it's been shown to be advantageous to use a so-called consensus or average or some kind of a representation that is, quote, more representative of the data that you're interested in mapping. So the notion of having average anatomies or average organs allows for this mapping to be carried out in a much more effective and efficient way. So as a result, though, you do lose anatomic detail because these average images, of course, are designed to average out individual variations. And so it does depend on the application that you're interested in. But there's been a lot of interest in terms of using these as substrates into which you map individual data to do population comparisons. And in that case, the consensus brains are shown to be certainly a lot more effective in those tasks.
Mm-hmm. Sanjay, did you want to add to that?
Oh, no, I think James eloquently put that, so it's great, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Aviv?
I will just point out, I put a paper in the chat, which is a perspective review paper, that myself and several colleagues, including Rahul Satija, was mentioned earlier, wrote in 2019, that actually goes through this kind of question and also addresses it in the context of different organs. Like, this would actually be different if you ask this question on the gut than if you ask the question about the brain, because the gut and the brain are organized very differently, as well as in the context of diseased tissues like tumors, where you can no longer talk about the reference in this fixed way, because every tumor is different, but any pathologist would also tell you the tumors of the related class are also similar. It's just that they're not that similar. They're similar in a different way of thinking about the common coordinates, and we go through that in the paper. It's an elaborate topic.
Thank you. And we have just a few minutes left. I wonder, do the panelists have any questions at all for each other or anything like that in the few minutes that we have left?
Yeah, I mean, one of the, you know, with all this great work and this data that's coming, which is mind-boggling, you know, how to handle this, I think, you know, body, of course, works in an integrated fashion, right? So I'm just wondering, you know, one of the big challenges really how to take advantage of all these data to biologically mine and integrate crosstalk between organs, and why does it matter in what context? You know, this to me is like one of the biggest challenges, whether we talk about spatial niches and the neighborhoods and pathways in each organ, because they are repetitive themes, but those themes may not actually work in the same concerted fashion. So I'm just wondering, all the, you know, the other panelists, you know, like how they're handling these issues often while they're generating all the data sets.
Yes, Aviv?
I will start maybe. I think Kristin talked a little bit about our cross-tissue atlas, which was a partnership with GTEx. And I think the first level, before even the crosstalk, was really this comparison between cells that are the same, but are between different tissues. So, you know, your T cells, so different kinds of immune cells, different types of fibroblasts, different types of epithelial cells, you see them in different tissues. The comparison between them is in its own right extremely instrumental, including for understanding why, you know, Tregs would behave in one way in the context of one disease and differently in the context of different disease, because they're kind of the same, but they're not exactly. For the cross-tissue communication, I think one of the places we're actually going to be aided is going not just in the human, but working in human and in model organisms in the same time. Because in model organisms, we have the ability to track cells as they move. So some of the studies that I got very excited about in the last couple of years are ones where cells get engineered such that, say, they start their lives in the gut, and now they're moving to another tissue and having an impact there. And again, we know that these connections are important. And the second dimension at which I think this is incredibly interesting, and that's, of course, for immune cells, is particularly relevant. And we can see that also in the context of tumors, where we can track, say, T cells by their clonality based on their single cell profiles and see them in the blood and see them in the tumor, so we can relate them one to the other. The other context in which I think there's really exciting things going on is in the interaction with the nervous system, both with cells of the peripheral nervous system, like the enteric nervous system and neurons in ganglia, and in looking with spatial data at the nerves themselves, because that is one of the greatest places where we have cross-organ interaction in the body, and we can actually watch it. We don't just have to infer it. I think both experimental methods and computational are forthcoming around this.
Great. Thank you all. This was a wonderful panel, and thank you all so much for taking out some time at a very busy time of the year. I know some of you are double booked actually as we speak. So I really appreciate it for helping us get this event off to a fantastic start. So thank you very much, and I'll turn it back over to our hosts. And thank you very much.
Bye bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Great panel. Thanks, Todd, for hosting and moderating.
Thank you. Bye.